Years ago, you would see them more often. They're still around. In fact, there are places where they are a part of everyday life. Today, blimps and aerostats are made differently than they were in the 1940s. Using the latest technology and materials, they can carry heavy cargoes, tens of thousands of feet into the sky. Now, you probably know they can be used for communications, surveillance, and guidance. But what you might not know is, one of the most successful manufacturers of aerostats in the world is located in eastern North Carolina, near Elizabeth City. Today, we are going to visit Tcom on this edition of My Heart Will Always Be in Carolina. Sometimes in the skies over eastern North Carolina, you can see aerostats and blimps hovering or moving quietly overhead. It's a sight that most people only see on television, but it's been happening around here since the 1940s.
Welcome to the program. I'm Ken Mann. Balloons have been around a long time and used in war for a long time. There are records of them being used during the Civil War in this country. They're still a part of today's modern defense system.
In Weeksville, North Carolina, a company is manufacturing aerostats in the same hangar where blimps were housed during World War II.
There was only one lighter-than-air base on the East Coast, and that was Lakehurst, New Jersey, which everyone's familiar with. The Navy decided that it really looked like we were going to get into World War II. Blimps have been in World War I were historically used for anti-submarine work, and they felt that they were going to use them for that again. So they started looking to find places to put in more bases. The people here in this area did a fantastic campaign to have it put here, and they won. So on this land, the Navy built Weeksville Naval Air Station, lighter than air. It was the first base since Lakehurst. The original plans for the base called for just one hangar. The construction was started in mid-1941 and just included this hangar built of steel. Now, the base was still under construction when we got into World War II, so the Navy decided to increase the size of the base and add a second hangar. Now, the second hangar, because we were in World War II and conserving strategic materials, was built of wood. It was the prototype of the 17 wooden hangars that were blimp hangars that were built in the United States. The base went operational on April 1st, 1942. The Navy blimps that flew from here protected convoys going up and down the East Coast from German submarines. There were quite a few ships sunk off the coast until the base went operational. The blimps that flew from here was what the Navy called their K-ships. It was their smallest patrol airship, but it was also the most numerous. They were 252 foot long. They carried a crew of 13 to 15, and they could stay aloft for anywhere from 16 to 20 hours, depending on how much they stretched their fuel. After World War II, the mission of the base changed slightly to one of aircraft and vehicle storage. There was 600 and some aircraft and 1,500 vehicles stored on the property. Then the Navy moved one of their West Coast blimp squadrons to Weeksville, changed the name to Weeksville Naval Air Facility, and then formed a second blimp squadron here and one of the first helicopter anti-submarine squadrons. So you had the transition from the blimps to the helicopters, actually. The base stayed operational until 1957, and actually the early 50s, this was a very, very, very busy place. My records show there was probably close to 2,000 people actually living on the base, and that's not counting civilian employees or naval personnel that lived off the base. So you had the two blimp squadrons, you had the helicopter squadron, you had the overall command of all the East Coast blimp squadrons, Fleet Airship Wing 1, based here. And most people don't realize that when Oceana up in Virginia Beach was being upgraded to a master jet base, all their squadrons were transferred down here to Weeksville and operated from here. However, the Navy decided to close the base on June 30th, 1957. They maintained a housekeeping presence here. There were several significant events that happened after that, the first of which was the test inflation of the Echo communication satellite. That was done in this hangar. NASA used the hangar as a wind tunnel. They shot scale models of planes from an air cannon in one end of the hangar into a net at the other end of the hangar and took pictures of it as it went by. Recently discovered that the base was used as a staging facility for the Bay of Pigs invasion in Cuba. Even though the base was closed, there was still a lot happening here. However, in 1964, I want to say, the federal government sold the entire base to the state of North Carolina, who marketed it as an industrial park for 2 years, didn't get anywhere, and then sold the entire base to Westinghouse Electric. Now we're talking 100 and some buildings, over 1,000 acres in property. Westinghouse used this hangar as a production facility for cabinets. Initially TV and stereo cabinets, but then transitioned into bathroom and kitchen cabinets. Then in 1971, the company that I work for, Tcom, was formed as a subsidiary of Westinghouse in Columbia, Maryland, for the purpose of building tethered communication systems.
The name Tcom, because everybody thinks the dot-coms, but the name Tcom really comes from the tethered communications. So that's what we were back in 1971, and it was originally intended to be kind of a poor man's satellite, so to speak, where we were going to fly these balloons at 10,000 feet and use them as platforms for television, radio, or telephone communications. And so that was where Tcom came from. In the early 80s, it began to become more and more a company whose platform was used for surveillance. And so we had a test site down in the Bahamas, and that was used for drug interdiction to find track drug traffickers coming up. And then Customs got very involved with this. And so a number of sites were deployed or installed out in the Southwest, in Yuma, in Deming, Fort Huachuca. And so those sites were put out there, and Customs wanted to significantly expand that site, that system, that network. And so they let out a big contract for four new systems, four new sites with five options. Westinghouse thought that that was going to be kind of a natural follow-on for the work they'd already done. To their great surprise, GE won that contest. And that's when Westinghouse decided to sell Tcom. After a long process, we ended up selling Tcom on November 17th, 1989 to a leverage buyout, a management buyout. And so in 1989, Tcom left Westinghouse and became a privately held company. And the interesting thing is that GE had significant difficulty fielding the systems they had signed up with customs to supply. So that by August of 1990, just 9 months after Tcom was spun off, GE had come to Tcom and entered into a 10-year sole source contract with us to buy all their large aerostats from Tcom. As I like to say about these large aerostats, they are deceptively sophisticated, and a lot of people believe that they can build large aerostats. To date, we're really the only company that has built large with the tether providing the power and the communications. We're the only ones that produce those large systems.
Aerostats come in different designs depending on what they'll be used for.
And we have built different sizes. Our smallest currently is a 17-meter aerostat, 17 meters in length. That's used for surveillance in Iraq. They put them up at night with an infrared camera on them and use them for base security. In Afghanistan, they're using our 22-meter aerostat because that's at a higher altitude for the same purpose. We build several different sizes in between, 32, 38-meter aerostats. And they're a totally portable system. They can be mounted on a ship. They can be mounted on a tractor trailer. And again, used for surveillance purpose with a radar on them.
Purchasing an aerostat can be a little more involved than, say, buying an airplane.
What happens usually is we are approached by a customer, and that customer can be our armed services, foreign armed services, foreign governments. We've had aerostats all over the world. And they say, we would like to do this job, and we'd like to use an aerostat to do it. So we enter into discussions with them about what it is they want to carry aloft, how high they want to carry it, where they think about flying it from. And we take all that into consideration and say, okay, this is what you need, and we design it for them. So we actually produce the flex structures here. We assemble the mooring systems, the ground-based portion of our aerostat system, which I always use the analogy, it's a fishing pole lying on its side. And that's pretty much how it works. And then we integrate the systems here. Our facility in Columbia, Maryland does the engineering and also does the electronics, but everything is put together as a system here. From after it's been through testing, after we bring in the people who are going to be operating it, whether it's going to be ourselves, a subcontract to the customer, or training the customer's people to operate the systems. Most of that hands-on training for the customers is done here also. So after it's all that's taken place, we'll disassemble it, ship it to wherever it wants it's supposed to go, reassemble it on-site, and then do on-site qualifications and training of personnel there. We have, like I say, we've had aerostats all over the world. One of the best examples of the use of our aerostat was Kuwait. The government of Kuwait bought one of our systems. They installed it. It went operational the day before the invasion. They launched the aerostat, turned the radar on, and said, we have a problem here, because they could see the troops and everything massing on the border. The aerostat personnel were actually the ones who put out the warning, you're about to get invaded here. Unfortunately, when the invasion took place the next day, we lost track of our personnel. We had no idea what happened to them for, I believe it was 2 to 3 weeks. We didn't know if they were dead, alive, or what. Eventually, they came out across the desert and showed up in Saudi Arabia. That system has since been replaced and is still operational today. Even though Tcom is not a blimp builder, what we do is we lease space in our hangar to blimp operators and blimp manufacturers to bring their ships in, to service them. They are aircraft, so they require annual inspections, 100-hour inspections, to service them or change out logos. You know, when you see a blimp and it says MetLife on it, well, you know, a couple weeks ago that might have been Outback Steakhouse or something. You know, so that's what happens here. As I said, Tcom is not a blimp builder. However, we do build the envelope for certain models of blimps, the bag, if you want to call it that. So we'll build the envelope here. Typically, the envelope doesn't leave the hangar. the airship manufacturing company brings the rest of it in, the gondola, the engines, the fins, everything else that they need, and inflate and assemble the whole thing here. So even though Tcom's not a blimp manufacturer, we act as a service station for blimps. And that's why you see blimps flying around Elizabeth City, flying around this area. They're usually either en route here or leaving here, going somewhere else.
As you can see, it takes a large building to house the facilities necessary to manufacture an aerostat. This hangar is 960 feet long. It is 328 feet wide and is 190 feet tall on the inside from the floor to the ceiling. So, how does a structure this size stand up against the strong winds on the coast?
It was designed to move. The way it's built, it's designed to move. I know we had some bookcases upstairs, and we had the bookcase was tight against the beam of the building. And the wind was blowing very strong. You could see the bookcase, the shelves in the bookcase rise and fall because of the people didn't realize the building was moving that much, but it moved several inches back and forth the way it was built. So that's unique in itself for the building.
At one time, Tcom was actually in a larger hangar located at this same site. It was the largest wooden structure in the world. On August the 3rd, 1995, something unimaginable happened. The hangar caught fire and was completely destroyed.
Well, in the mid-1990s, the box beam was a 20-foot by 20-foot beam that provided, like I say, the upper channels for the doors to open and close. It was a 232-foot spread between the pillars, and that was beginning to sag. And just over time and wear. And so we had hired a company to put in partial arches on each side of those doors and that to hold it up. And on the night of August 2nd, 1995, a welder was up there cutting off a bolt. And because all the wood was fire retardant, he left it and there was no fire, but the bolt was sufficiently hot that it actually started a fire up in that box beam. And so when it was finally determined that that was a fire, which was 9 or 10 o'clock on the night of August 2nd, the fire department was called, but we really didn't have any equipment that could get to that height. And so that fire just progressed to burn. The good thing that there was nobody injured or lost in the fire, but as a result of that, all of Tcom's inventory, its product, its manufacturing equipment was destroyed in that fire, except for two aerostats we had outside the hangar at that time. But that burned from August 2nd to the morning of August 3rd, and that was a big loss for Tcom. That really put the whole future of the company in question.
The decision to stay in Weeksville and continue with the business was based largely on the dedication, qualifications, and determination of Tcom's North Carolina employees.
I think they can rise to the occasion and have proven that on many times, and I think that's what they based a lot of their thought processes on, making the decision to stay here. I've been here quite a while, and I've done a lot of jobs, you know, within this organization, from field operations for 15 years to the manufacturing side of it that we're here today. And I've always felt that one of the reasons for success in those areas has been the people themselves. And I've been fortunate enough to have good people around me. And it's very important to be successful to have very good people around you.
You know, the people are very highly skilled, and they're just, this is not an industry that you find capable people around the country in. And so at the end of the day, we made the decision to buy back the furniture facility, the hangar we're in today, from Triangle Pacific. And you know, by the grace of God, this has turned out to be a much better facility than we had before, and it really has enabled us to do a lot of things we couldn't have done in the old facility. So As in much in life, I mean, the fire turned out to be a good thing, although very challenging at the time.
One must ask, what does the future hold for a product that's been in existence for such a long period of time and whose mission has evolved during these many years into what it is today?
Tcom has experienced some good years and some rather lean years. In the lean years, maybe our workforce here got to be as low as 30, 35 people. Today, I believe we have over 150 folks working at this facility and our mooring system facility next door. In terms of you know, obviously the salaries and the like that we pay them are significant, but then we also do a lot of subcontracting to local contractors here as well. And I believe this year that very well may exceed $30 million worth of content that we buy and bring in for the mooring systems especially. The Tcom, like I said at the beginning, stands for tethered communications. And tethered communication, a tethered platform only allows you to to provide surveillance at a fixed site. Increasingly, there is interest in having lighter-than-air platforms that are untethered. And that really is, I believe, where the future is going to be in lighter-than-air, untethered vehicles. And so both the Army and the Air Force and other people around the world are working to develop large, untethered, lighter-than-air vehicles. Some of these may be what we call a hybrid air vehicle, which is more of a wing-shaped design to get more aerodynamic lift as opposed to purely helium lift. But other companies are looking at developing large airships up to a million or even 2 million cubic feet in size that would provide a long dwell time, untethered, over the battlefields in Afghanistan and Iraq or wherever we may find ourselves in the future. The importance of this airborne surveillance, this persistent surveillance, is essential for our success in these efforts. And that while there are many other platforms up there now, like the Predator and the Global Hawk and the like, it's projected that an airship can operate at 1/10 the operational cost and provide much longer dwell times, much greater payload than any of these other vehicles. And so there's a huge interest in developing those, and we're working with a number of companies right now to develop that next generation of lighter-than-air product.
It is hard to find the words to describe what you see when you first walk into the hangar. Groups can tour the Tcom facility. Tours are normally given on Wednesdays at 3 p.m. They do require advanced reservations.
Were you surprised to see all of this in eastern North Carolina? Thank you so much for watching. I hope you'll join us again next week for more people, places, and things from the Outer Banks and northeastern North Carolina. I'm Ken Mann. May God bless you richly. My heart.